Hi guys, and welcome to Rathwulven Bushcraft. Thanks a lot for tuning in, and please buckle up, because today we're gonna talk about bushcraft bullsh. Let's go. Okay, before we get to the actual topic of this video, let me quickly explain the intention behind this series. There are a lot of misconceptions out there in the bushcraft world. There's a lot of misunderstandings in regards to wilderness living skills, to survival skills, and sometimes there's also misconduct from certain types of bushcrafters that are kind of a role model to many of you out there, also to me. And I just want to talk about different types of topics that are nonsense, bullshit, right? And this series never intends at addressing somebody in person. You know, it's not a personal offense towards you. Might be that throughout this episode or throughout a further episode in the future, you might get the feeling like, hey, he's talking about me. Well, this is not about you as a person. This is more about knowledge, about urban legends, about misconduct and things that I personally think need to be addressed if we want to become better bushcrafters. This video series aims at educating people and aims at in basically realizing a debate, okay? So, that said, let's just get started with this very video. Maybe you heard about this story that you could use moss as an antibacterial type of gauze for your wounds, like just a patch like this on top of a cutting wound or so should basically kill off bacteria and help you to patch that up in case of an emergency up until you get professional help. And nothing is further from the truth. Please erase this idea out of your head. It's not a survival skill, it's a really stupid idea. And in order to understand why this is, we have to look at a bit of history. We also have to look at a bit of microbiology. And by the end of the video, you will understand all the connections that are of essence for that topic, okay? So please bear with me. I say we just start off with history. First and foremost, if we go back in time, prehistoric men or early men like the Egyptians, the Mesopotamians, the Babylonians and so on, had to work with natural resources all the time. There was no industry that was producing products like, for example, these bandages, right? There was no modern technology, there was no science in terms of microbiology, pathology, chemistry, and so on. So people used whatever they could find. And as you might picture, a piece of moss like this looks like it has the perfect attributes, right? It's kind of spongy, it's kind of sucking up moisture. So why not use this for medical purposes? Well, this has been perpetuated throughout time. A milestone would be the year 1014. And we have to go to Ireland, to the Battle of Clontarf. And what's really interesting about this battle, the documentation of this battle is one of the first historical documents that does speak about the use of moss as a medical item, right? So picture this, you're on the battlefield, just with a sword and a shield, and you're just smacking the hell out of your enemy. And then you get sliced. Maybe you get like a huge cut across your arm. And then you need some kind of dressing for that wound, right? Again, there are no modern products like this. And then you just use whatever you can find. You take moss, you put it on, you wrap that up, and if you're lucky, you survive the injury. Chances are, though, that you bleed to death, right? So it's not a particularly effective way of treating these wounds. When it comes to cloth as some sort of bandage, people didn't have a lot back in the days. We're talking about medieval times. So probably you were wearing your tunic and had nothing else. There were no medics on the field. Maybe if you're lucky, a priest or some sort of healer, and you just tried whatever you could do. It was more likely that people actually prayed to God, you know, not to let them die than to actually administer first aid. And so it came to be that throughout those centuries and centuries in the past, we just stuck to those means of medicine and just perpetuated this up until times like the Napoleonic Wars, right? And it gets really, really interesting in the First World War, because if we picture the First World War right now, then we do see those horrible trench fights, right? Many people, especially young men, getting injured, you know, many of them dying. And as you might picture, we're just also in the very early stage of the industrial age. So we just started to produce medicinal items or medical items on an industrial scale, like gauzes, plasters, and all these kind of things. And of course, as it goes with war, there's always a shortage. Might be due to the transport, you know, that your medics are not supplied with medical equipment. Might also be due to the production, that the production cannot keep up with that. And two names are of importance here. Those are Isaac Balfour, a botanist and an expert in plant science, and Charles Cuthcart, who was like a surgeon in the army, British Army, if I remember correctly. And what those two did was doing some research on alternative medicine and substitutes for gauzes and bandages. And it turned out that they figured out that two types of moss of the family sphagnum, kind of like almost look like these, did have antibacterial characteristics. So those two families could be used as improvised wound dressings. And that's a really important point to understand from the historical perspective, because if we take those two families, the papillosum and the palustre, so sphagnum palustre and sphagnum papillosum, those two could be used for improvised dressings up until people were loaded on trucks or onto some kind of horse carriages and were brought to some sort of medical personnel that could treat the wounds properly. And there's one big issue, like this is the main source that always resonates up until today. They are often quoted for their findings of these two types of mosses, but now let's just look at the numbers, right? Sphagnum as a family of moss, that's the peat mosses in English, by the way, do contain around 380 to 450 varieties. So think about this in terms of odds, you know, I'm just going out here into the forest, and I'm just gonna pick a piece of moss like this, and I know that this is probably sphagnum, right? How could I know whether this is one of the two that actually do have antibacterial characteristics and maybe not like one of the other 450 varieties, right? And then we're just talking about sphagnum. We're not talking about all the other families of mosses that are out there in the world. We're not talking about lichens either. So as you can see, you know, the odds of getting an antibacterial type of plant are so little. We're talking 2 to a couple of thousands. And that's very important to understand, because if you go out there into the forest, you probably have the same experience that I do. You know, if you see moss and then you just recognize this as moss, I bet you won't be able to just perfectly identify this particular variety and make a distinction between that and all the other thousand varieties. You would need to be a botanist, you would need to just look at all the tiny features in detail, and if it's for medical emergency especially, you don't have that time, and probably you also won't have the knowledge to understand which type is which, right? So this is the first problem that arises. What's also really important to understand is the chemistry of the forest floor. The forest floor is alive. And let's just take this. Like, this moss is moist. It's a very dry and sunny day, as you can see, but this is incredibly moist. And there's tiny microorganisms all across the type of moss, right? So we do have tiny little water pearls that are attached to the leaves. And in these water pearls, we do have amoeba. We do have certain types of protozoa. We do have certain types of bacteria dwelling in there. And this is really important, because we do have a lot of contaminants or pathogens that can create sicknesses, which are anaerobe. In case you don't know what that means, anaerobe means not dwelling in air. So they're basically dying if they are exposed to oxygen. But if they're somewhat in an oxygen-free environment, like for example these tiny water drops, like morning dew on top of that, or just the plant juices that are evaporated, or maybe rain, you know, then they just dwell in these tiny water pearls that are attached to the plant. And let's just take an example. One would be Clostridium tetani, the bacteria that cause tetanus. The Clostrida, as themselves, are all anaerobe, and there's many, many more bacteria that do also thrive in oxygen-free environments. Of course, there's also others that only thrive in oxygen-rich environments and would die if they would be depleted of oxygen. But just for simple demonstration, we just focus at the bacteria causing tetanus, okay? So those are all on there. And yeah, even if it rained, it might be that some animal passed by, you know, some droppings were just put out, the animal took a dump, you know, then it's washed away. It's just carried all across the forest floor. There's microorganisms dying, maybe tiny animals, bugs, worms, and so on. And those bacteria do thrive all across that forest floor. And now I get myself a cut. Let's say I'm whittling and I just cut myself in my thumb and I think like, yeah, okay, that's going to be fine. I just need to get some kind of plaster. But, you know, before going home, I'm just gonna patch this up with moss. And then at home, I'm gonna clean the wound and then I'm just gonna put on a proper plaster. Maybe you got a scenario like this. And then you take this and you put this on your cut, right? What are you doing then? Well, first of all, you are creating contact between those water pearls on the moss that do contain certain bacteria like the Clostridium tetani, right? And you put them into your wound. And by actually covering up your wound with the moss, you are blocking this wound from any kind of atmospheric exchange. So there's no oxygen that gets to your wound and kills off these bacteria. The contrary is the case. You're actually cultivating those bacteria by enabling them to grow faster and thrive in the perfect environment, because you might have blood in there, plasma, maybe a bit of pus, and then of course all the liquids of the moss. So if you press that on, you're actually contaminating yourself, might get tetanus, or if you talk about other bacteria and other pathogens, completely different types of diseases. The same accounts also for spores, for example. There might be certain types of mold that are just all across that floor by means of spores. You know, spores do just disperse into the air and then they just attach to these moist surfaces, right? Maybe also the same thing accounts for viruses. It certainly does account for protozoa, for amoeba, another type of tiny microorganisms. So yeah, very simplified, this means that if we are using moss as a substitution for a bandage, we're just increasing the risk of complications in regards to healing the wound. We're not accelerating the healing process. We're not sterilizing the wound. We are actually making things worse. And the only exception might then indeed be like one of those two varieties that those scientists from the First World War found. And all the others bring certain risks, right? So I hope this all makes sense to you, because it's a really important topic. I still see people, including survival trainers or outdoor coaches or, you know, people that give seminars and such, talk about the benefits of using moss as an antibacterial and anti-inflammatory plant that can be used for dressing wounds. It still happens up until today. And you can't really blame these people, because if you got the wrong sources or you don't have further sources or further understanding of the microbiology and such, it sounds kind of convenient, right? It sounds logical if you hear about those two guys from the First World War that figured out a temporary solution, right? Also a word about those sphagnum mosses, by the way. It's really interesting also for the context. Sphagnum in Germany is almost extinct. It's on the number 3 on the scale of extinct plants. So we do have a categorization, and 3 means severely endangered. This accounts for the Federal Republic of Germany as a whole. In the province of the Saarland, the sphagnum mosses are extinct. If we look at Switzerland, sphagnum papillosum is already on the red list, so it's also an endangered species. And it does mainly grow indeed in Ireland. So I think this is also where this idea comes from with this early medieval battle that we were talking about. Because just in their respective area, chances are that you might find this moss and that you might use this to your advantage. But again, are you proficient enough in plant identification and in the science of botany to identify those two particular types of mosses in comparison to all the others and just make a proper distinction and then apply it properly, right? So yeah, all in all, to summarize this, just don't use that, you know, just make sure that you always carry a first aid kit. If you don't know how to build yourself one, I'm gonna give you a link right up here in the information box. Just click that. This is my personal first aid kit that I always carry. I have this right here in my backpack. It's always good to have these modern medical items with you, because we live in times in which they're easily accessible, in which they're cheap, and you should not take chances, because accidents do happen. Could be that tiny cut, but it could also be a more severe injury. So educate yourself about this, follow first aid classes, and get to the most actual and the most recent understanding of medicine. Be educated, stay up to date. It's really important. I personally do follow at least one first aid course per year. Usually it's two, because I also need to do them for the work that I'm doing next to shooting these videos. But nevertheless, it's a pretty serious issue. Because it might be that you're a beginner, you read this in some kind of survival book, like, okay, you don't have a plaster ready, just try this. Just like a one-liner that recommends that, and then you do that. And for whatever reason, you might not be vaccinated against tetanus, or you might not have any kind of other equipment ready, or you might not know how to use that. Maybe you don't know how to use birch polypores as plasters, for example, or other kind of plants. And then you just do this because you're like, oh, moss, you put it on top, you create an anaerobe environment, you cultivate bacteria in your wound, you get complications, and all of a sudden you get into bigger trouble than you might have expected. Maybe you get some type of blood poisoning, right? It's absolutely not worth the risk, and everybody who's advocating this survival skill should stop immediately in doing so, because the context is really important. Yes, if you are in a situation in which it's do or die, then you can give this a try. But I think that many people absorb this kind of useless pseudo-information and then engage in experiments, right? And when they do so, they get into complications, it's a risk for their health, and by the end, you're harming people. So yeah, all I can say is, take the information I gave you into consideration, understand that this technique, in my opinion, can be labeled bushcraft bullshit. And if you want to add something to that, or if you have a question, leave a comment below. If you have additional information, or if you want to debate this, make sure you reach out. Let's have a discussion about that. Let's learn together, okay? And if this series is of interest to you, also make sure to subscribe, because there will be more. And I'm really curious how this is going to turn out, but yeah, I will talk about further misconceptions, because there are a lot out there. And yeah, if you got any suggestion, by the way, also drop me a comment below. It's always helpful. I would very much appreciate this. And yeah, again, if you like that, make sure you subscribe to the channel and support whatever I'm doing right here. Give me a thumbs up. And yeah, I hope I will see you next time. Hope this was of value to you. Let me know. Up until then, take it easy. Ciao.